Okay, good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Gerald R. Ford Presidential Library. My name is Gary Gunderson, Supervisory Archivist here at the Library. We're very pleased to have such a large overflow crowd with us this evening on this wonderful spring day, and I think spring is finally here, I hope. Before we get started, just a few quick housekeeping chores. Please turn off all cell phones and other electronic items. We are videotaping our program this evening, so when we get to the question and answer session, please go to the microphone in the center aisle at the back of the auditorium to ask your questions. And please remember, questions only and no public statements. As interesting as you all are, so. And we would also like to thank the Gerald R. Ford Presidential Foundation and Friends of Ford for their financial support of our program tonight. And now on to the program. Between February 1971 and July 1973, President Richard Nixon secretly recorded 3,700 hours of his phone calls and meetings across the executive offices. These recordings came to light during the Watergate scandal and played a leading role in the resignation of our 37th president on August 9, 1974. The tapes are perhaps the greatest treasure of information ever left by a president, as well as the most complex and controversial set of presidential records in American history, which coincidentally were seized by President Ford and turned over to the National Archives. Our speaker tonight has spent the last decade listening to almost 3,000 hours of publicly released Nixon tapes, just let that sink in, which has given him a unique perspective on this controversial president and the personalities and events captured on tape. Along with being a noted expert on the Nixon tapes, Dr. Luke Nichter is an associate professor of history at Texas A&M University. He is co-author of six books, including Richard Nixon and Europe, The Reshaping of the Post-War Atlantic World, and the Nixon Tapes, 1971 to 1972, and a sequel, The Nixon Tapes, aptly titled 1973. His website, nixontapes.org, offers free access to all 3,000 hours of publicly available tapes as a public service. So if you're running out of things to watch on TV, this is the place to go. Dr. Nichter has also conducted much research at the Ford Library over the years and is considered one of our favorite researchers. And we have very high standards, I might add. So it's my pleasure to welcome Luke Nichter back to the Ford Presidential Library. Luke.
Thank you. Wow, what a great crowd. So you've all been looking at this baby for the time that you've been here and wonder who is this little person. And I think first, I'll get to that in a minute, but a decade with the Nixon tapes, what we've learned and what we have yet to learn. Before I get started, I want to thank also the Gerald Ford Library and Foundation. It was Red Cavaney, the chairman of the foundation, who first came up with the idea last November for me to be here and give this talk. So all credit is due to the foundation for bringing me here. But without any further wait, since you're all wondering who this baby is, my wife always reminds me that at the time that I was trying and planning to give birth to an 800-page book, you can see where this is going. She had the much more difficult and important job of giving birth to our daughter. And so she came out, she was born about 3 months when the book was, she was about 3 months old in this photo when the first book came out. So, and in fact, we joke sometimes among ourselves that probably in that first year of her life, because I work at home and I'm playing tapes all the time when I was working on these books, she probably thought for a period of time that Richard Nixon was her grandfather. So before you accuse me of any kind of abuse or anything, you know, hear me out. There's a reason behind that in a story. But that's the personal touch here that we start with. So moving on, you know, why would someone want to listen to Richard Nixon for 10 years? 10 years and counting. It's been kind of closer to 12 at this point. I think some people conclude that if I didn't have some kind of psychological problem when I decided this was a good idea 10 years ago, I surely have one now. But really, I was a graduate student. I grew up in Northwest Ohio. I was a grad student at Bowling Green State University. A little more was 75 minutes or so from here, down Route 23. And I was in the history program there and looking for a research topic. I think much like any graduate student, doesn't matter what you're in, geology, sciences, political science, history, you have it kind of pounded into your head by your advisor. You have to find something new. You have to make your mark on something. And even more importantly than that, when you have a couple months during the winter with no sunshine and snow on the ground, it has to be something that's exciting enough for you to get up and go to the library when everyone else is sitting at home and get your research done. And come up here and make the drive up here a number of times too. And the best advice that I got at that time, which is advice that I pass on to my own graduate students, is choose something new. Choose something on the archival frontier, as historians call it. The archival frontier. The idea that for everyone else, historians, what's new to historians is often 25, 30, 40, 50, or more years old to everyone else. Because it takes 20, 30, it takes that long, this usually measured in decades, for records to be released by the National Archives, by presidential libraries. And so historians always kind of do the final mopping up job of history. You know, first you have the memoirs, journalists do the writing of history, then the political scientists and the social scientists come along a few years after that with their particular research methodologies, and then finally the historians, after nobody cares anymore. It's all old. And most of the time, everybody's gone. This is a rare case where many figures are still around. And so for me, you know, rewinding the clock 30 or 40 years, kind of put myself in the late 1960s, the early 1970s, as I was thinking about what I might do. And that's more or less the end of the Johnson years or the beginning of the Nixon years. And so for me, I was initially turned off by the idea of doing anything on Richard Nixon, let alone the Nixon tapes, because I really didn't think we had much new to learn about the Nixon tapes. I mean, go to any big library. How many books are there already on Watergate, Nixon, Kissinger, China, Vietnam, the Soviet Union? Just shelves and rows full of books. I thought, given that, how am I going to make my mark and find my own way through all that and find something new to say? And besides that, knowing that records take so long to get released. I know when I was doing this research in the later stages, I remember reading a story one day that a World War I document had been declassified by the government. I thought, World War I? And what could possibly still be secret from World War I? And the agency that released the record was the National Security Agency, which didn't exist in World War I, on top of that. And you'll never guess, the document, I remember reading it, it was one page, it was a recipe for invisible ink, which obviously had some kind of continued operational significance to justify its closure over those decades. So records can take a very long time to get released in some cases. So for me, I know much more now than I did then. Then it seemed like all this had been written already about the Nixon tapes and about the Nixon administration, the Nixon presidency, and the various policies. Now, looking back, at that time, only about 5 to 7% of the tapes had been transcribed at that time. Almost completely on Watergate, abuses of power, and those related subjects. Stanley Cutler published the most in his big books. There are a few other people, John Dean, Bob Woodward, who'd used tapes. But you know, no one had really done anything comprehensive. You know, they were already at that stage umpteen books about the Kennedy tapes and the Johnson tapes, which were far smaller and really less consequential for either US history or for the presidency. But no one had really comprehensively done anything with the Nixon tapes because they were just so daunting in terms of size and the audio quality. So sticking on the archival frontier, I thought, well, we'll do something. I started listening to tapes on Europe, started to come up to here to look at records up here to do with US-European relations. It's what I ended up writing my dissertation on. But as I was getting started, the voices, these are not voices in my head, these are voices on the tapes, although sometimes people ask me, don't you dream about these tapes and don't you hear Nixon in your sleep? Thankfully, the answer to all these questions is no, and honestly, no. But you know, starting out on this, you don't even know who the voices are listening to these tapes. I mean, they're analog recordings. I mean, Nixon has a very identifiable voice. Henry Kissinger has a very identifiable voice. But there are some that are just impossible due to the audio quality or people talking over each other. The bigger the room, you know, the worse it is. Because, you know, let me give you a few facts about the tapes. Presidents going back to FDR taped. Nixon wasn't the first. FDR recorded around 10 hours of his press conferences. due to his disability that we know a lot more about today than people did back then, he would invite the press into the Oval Office and have press conferences, or what was used as the Oval Office, and that's not the same room today. Truman recorded, and Eisenhower, and it really took a step forward. Kennedy and Johnson started to record at that point in the 1960s in the hundreds of hours, because the technology had advanced enough where they could do that. But Nixon, though, was interesting, because Nixon winning election in 1968, Lyndon Johnson invited him to the White House, that customary meeting between the incoming and the outgoing president that takes place every time there's a presidential election. And as far as we know, you know, people say, well, why did Nixon tape? You know, these tapes were so damaging to him. The tour of the White House that day, Johnson told him about his taping system. Johnson apparently even lifted up his own mattress, and all the wiring was underneath it, because Johnson had telephones everywhere, the bathroom and a lot of his rooms. And if you ever have a chance to, in Texas, close to where I teach, visit the Lyndon Johnson Ranch. It's a property of the National Park Service. You can see all these phones that were everywhere. They've left them, they've been recreated them and repositioned them the way they were when Johnson was alive. So just getting started on this was impossible. You know, the State Department was also transcribing some tapes when I was getting started. And you might remember that Congress, for a number of years, for a generation, was the committees, all the powerful committees were controlled by Southerners. And to me, you get a cabinet room full of Southerners, and I can't tell Wilbur Mills of Ways and Means from anybody else in the room. And so there are certain conversations that I'm telling you, we're just not gonna get very easily until technology somehow can recognize voices. You know, we're just not there as long as we rely on the human ear to figure out who's talking and what they're saying. So just getting the basic voices down, you know, took a good 6 months of listening all the time. And beyond that, as you're listening to tapes, you realize you don't know enough about what you're listening to. Because to do the tapes, you really need really just two skills, but both of them are critical. You had to know, at any point you kind of drop in and listen, you had to know what they're talking about. So you have to know the history of the Nixon years well enough. And there were a lot of people who knew that better than I did at that time as a graduate student. And the second skill is the one that most academics don't have, the technological skills. You have to be able to edit audio and kind of clean up audio and make it sound better and improve it and try to find that piece of audio that you can't hear very well to do things to it that make it more audible. And a lot of people did that better than me. I was a historian. But I was the one that could at least do both skills passably well, and I was willing to try it. Where there was a great fear of failure, too. And on top of that, many of the records from the time period were just being declassified. The Nixon Library, at the Ford Library here. So the records you need. So you're listening to a conversation. You're hearing a shuffle of paper. Well, what are they looking at? Was it the daily news summary that morning? Trying to track down those records. And many times the records weren't opened yet. So I had to file a series of records requests, the Freedom of Information Act and other vehicles to get records released, over 1,000 to date, just to support the drive, the release of a lot of records, so that help with the tapes work. And in case you're curious about the photo, this was a photo of Nixon's cabinet taken around the time that taping began. But just a couple more comments about the tapes before we move on. So Nixon was not the first one to tape. Presidents before him, back to FDR, taped. What Nixon did that was different than anyone else was he taped more than all the rest combined. Initially, and there are experts here, even in the room, who know more about this than I do, from the National Archives. Initially, they estimated there were 5,000 hours of tapes, because you don't know. I mean, you have all these reels, and you know what the capacity of each reel is, but how much blank space is there on each one? And until you get down to that last second, you don't know. And then they brought the total down to 3,700. So you know they're getting a better handle on how much there is. And as of last year now, they say 3,451, 3,451 hours is the latest total. But we still don't know exactly until we get to the very end of releasing everything. So, and the other major difference I'll say about Nixon before moving on is not only did he tape more than anyone else, Nixon used the latest technology in the day. In the early 70s, you had voice-activated or sound-activated technology. And so what Nixon did was he, unlike all those before him, people sometimes say, well, why did Nixon tape this? It's so damaging to him. It's terrible. Why did he talk that way? Well, he couldn't control it. He couldn't turn it on and off. Whereas Kennedy and Johnson could turn the recording on when it suited them, they could turn it off when it suited them. and Nixon's was sound activated. He wore a kind of pager-like device. See, when I talk to my 18-year-olds in my class, they don't know what pagers are. But he wore a kind of pager-like device issued to him by the Secret Service. And when it was within range of one of the locations that was taped, the Oval Office and two phones, the Executive Office Building and one of the phones, the Lincoln sitting room upstairs in the residence, Camp David and a phone, the cabinet room also was part of the system. If it came within range of one of these, the cabinet room was operated a little differently. But for the rest of them, if it came within range, the system turned on automatically. So it captured everything. And sometimes it didn't even capture Nixon. The dogs could be barking. I was talking to one original National Archives processor of the tapes yesterday. It's just one of my jobs was to figure out which dog it was that was barking. I guess yesterday was National Pet Day, I think, so it's appropriate to mention that. Cleaning crews sometimes, staff members setting up for meetings about to take place or tearing down for meetings that have just concluded. Sometimes Nixon would leave his jacket in the Oval Office and step outside of the Rose Garden, or you could hear the whir of the blades of Marine One on the south lawn of the White House. So you get lots of non-historical background noise that's also pretty historical and interesting too, even though it's not really a conversation. So the tapes included lots of things that you might not expect. And so as I was beginning this work, I was about 2 years into it, it was a means to an end. I was hoping to graduate and graduate on time, hopefully find a job at the end of all this. I wasn't sure where it was leading, but I was listening and kind of working on my dissertation. And I tell you, a lot of stories about the various Nixon White House people that I've had a chance to meet and talk to. But this is one of my favorite stories that I get to tell. There was one day I'll never forget when I was walking up. See, the graduate students worked in this flood-prone basement of Williams Hall, the oldest building on campus. And every spring there was about this much water on the floor. It was the best place to work because nobody wanted to go down there. And so my students couldn't find me, anyone who wanted to find me, so I had all these hours to listen to the tapes. And there was one, you had to walk upstairs to the main office to check your little mailbox. And I walked up there and checked the mailbox, and a secretary kind of nearby said to me, "You just missed a phone call from Henry Kissinger's office." And I thought, this is back in Wi-Fi really didn't exist yet, and cell phones could barely penetrate these 100-year-old building walls. And at first, my reaction to it was, yeah, right. At first, I thought, this must be my roommate, you know, playing a joke on me and wanting to make me feel as important as I probably thought I was at the time, you know, working on these presidential recordings. And so I took a little piece of paper she wrote the name and the number down to, and I kind of put it in my pocket, didn't pay a lot of attention to it. And it was a couple days later that week, that I looked at it. I thought, well, maybe there's something to this. You know, no roommates told me that, you know, that it was a joke or anything. Maybe there's something to this. And I looked up the name and Googled the name, probably a Yahoo search then. I don't know if Google existed yet. And I saw that the person had been thanked a few times in a couple of Henry Kissinger's recent books. I thought, well, maybe this is real. And it was a 201 area code, which I knew was kind of New Jersey outside of New York, and I knew Kissinger was still based in New York. So I called the number. And when Teresa answered the phone, Teresa Amantia, his assistant, she said, "Dr. Kissinger would like to meet with you as soon as possible." And still to this day, I have no idea, you know, how he found. I was just a student, you know, working on a project, a dissertation. I had no idea how. Still to this day, there was no website, there was no books. There's no way he would have known me from anybody. And at that point, I didn't even know anybody who had interviewed Dr. Kissinger or met with him. He's not someone who gives a lot of interviews, especially not to academics who are probing and asking interesting questions. I couldn't even think of anyone who'd met him recently. I remembered someone I knew, James Rosen, had just written a book about Nixon Attorney General John Mitchell that had come out, I think, in 2006 or 7, sometime around then. And I remember reading something in the footnotes about he had tried to interview Kissinger, and I think he was unsuccessful. And so I talked to him, and I said, and when I told him about the phone message, he said, "If you can get an interview with Henry Kissinger in less than 5 years, you've done better than the industry average." I didn't tell him, but he said he wants to come meet him right now. And so he didn't say what he wanted to meet about, didn't offer to pay my travel from Texas, and you know, living on a graduate student stipend, it'd be expensive now, it was really expensive then. And went up to New York, Kissinger's office, Kissinger Associates. He had just started to sort of slow down. He was by 86 then, only running one consulting company instead of two. He was running two for a while, Kissinger Associates and Kissinger McLarity Associates. McLarity was one of Clinton's chief of staff. It was a very kind of bipartisan consulting company. So he's running just Kissinger Associates now, and the office is still where it is today, just a little north of Grand Central Station. And you go in the building and show up at the right time. And like all New York buildings, they have kind of a directory of the whole building when you walk inside the elevators. It tells you where to go. And so I'm looking for the 24th floor because he's on the 24th floor. Look at the directory. There is no 24th floor. I think, well, I'm in the wrong place. I'm going to be late. I better get going. And I thought, maybe I'm in the right place because he's just prone to so many stories about secrecy over the years. And this is not somebody who wants to be found by someone walking in off the street. So I went to the guard desk and checked in. They gave me an ID badge. I was in the right place. And they pointed me to the one elevator that went up to that floor and went up there. And you enter, come off, there's a whole big waiting room you come off in. All Chinese motif. Furniture, screens, artwork, everything. And of course, that's what he wants to be known for. Only someone like Henry Kissinger can write a book called On China, which is one of his most recent books that came out. And after all, I mean, what would you expect? Is it going to be a Cambodian motif or something else? I mean, of course it's going to be China. This is the story. And he's also someone notorious, if you read other accounts, of sometimes making people wait, sometimes hours, to meet with him. And I was brought in just a few minutes into the office. Very nice staff and very helpful. And brought into a corner office. And the corner office, if you saw a skit, if you didn't see it, a Stephen Colbert skit a few years ago, I'm sure you can find it on YouTube today. There's this skit of Stephen Colbert, of Kissinger in his office. You can find it on YouTube. I'm sure if you look for Nixon or Kissinger Colbert, where Colbert jumps out of Kissinger's closet and dances around and does Stephen Colbert things. And Kissinger picks up the phone and says, "Get me security." And they throw him out. That is the office that I saw that day, the one you can find on YouTube. 24th floor, L-shaped, glass all the way up and down, the whole skyline of Manhattan. I mean, it was impressive. And I'm there not to be a tourist, and I want to stop and look around at all the stuff in the office. And what I noticed on the entire L-shape of the office, 3, 4, 5 deep, are photos. Photos of him, taken with prominent people that he's known over his life and career. Many of them I could see were signed. I only saw a few. I think I saw Eisenhower, I saw Kennedy, and world leaders of all stripe, you know, and color you can think of from all over the world, from early in his career, 50s until the present day. And so I tried to see a few of these things. And as I was getting in there, he was sitting in the corner chair. There's a couch and a corner chair, and I walk in, and I was putting my phone away, just like I was today, putting it on silent. And the first thing I do is I pull it out, I'm putting it on silent, and he interrupts me and says, "No recording devices." And I thought to myself, I would never secretly record him, but I thought, you know, I guess if you've been secretly recorded once before in the past, it is a legitimate concern that you might be secretly recorded again. But I put it away. I said, "No, I'm just putting my phone away so we're not disturbed." And it was one of the most interesting, strangest meetings I've ever had. It was scheduled for 20 minutes. Is someone still having meetings at sort of 10 and 20 minute intervals throughout his day, almost at 90 years of age? And we ended up going about an hour beyond that, hour and 15 minutes over his lunch. And I'll tell you what we talked about in a minute. But as I was sitting down, the first thing he said to me was, "Why are you here?" I thought, "You call the meeting." But what I said was, I had a filter between thought and word. And I said, "I'm a student. I'm working on these tapes. I'm listening to them, transcribing them. Probably work on a book one day. But right now, I'm a student." And he said, "If you want to know the policies of the Nixon administration, you must study the memoranda between the president and myself." And I said, "True, but with all due respect, a tape shows much more. I mean, a tape shows kind of all options considered, you know, with the bark off, as LBJ would say, political motivations kind of laid bare, kind of which option won out, many times even how they reflected after the fact. Well, that didn't work very well, or it did work well." And I said, "So a tape shows, you know, a lot more than a memorandum, which might have been written by a staff person who wasn't even present in the meeting in question. It had been cleaned up over a number of drafts before for public or political consumption. So it's a tape show, lots more." So a whole process that doesn't exist in a memorandum. And he said, give me an example. And I had a little, I had a laptop with me. I didn't plan to bring a lot of tape clips. I'll play a couple for you tonight of President Gerald Ford. So if you haven't heard them, you can hear a couple. And you can't do a lot in 20 minutes. I mean, I didn't realize we were going to go over, but I brought a few. And I remember as I was getting them ready and loading them up, and he was showing some interest, I thought back to what he's written about the Nixon tapes, because he hasn't said very much about them. I mean, probably apart from Nixon, you could argue that Kissinger's probably been hurt the most by the tapes. They've damaged him the most. And a whole generation of Nixon advisors, I have some sympathy for, because they've gone on to have careers. Many of them had great careers. George H.W. Bush was ambassador to the UN then. Dick Cheney was a young aide to Donald Rumsfeld. George Shultz, I mean, some pretty big names in politics over the next 20 or 30 years. They have one thing in common. They could never go on and have their own careers fully independent from Nixon again, because they were on these tapes, whether they liked it or not. They had to face what Nixon said about them behind their backs when they left the day, and haunt them politically, many of them, for decades. So this isn't pleasant for many of them. The fact the tapes existed, many of them felt betrayed and thought it was, and some of them advised him to destroy the tapes when there was a chance to do that. And for whatever reason, he did not do that. But thinking back to Kissinger, probably damaged more than the rest of these names, because he's on there just so many times. He's in the Oval Office almost 6-8 times a day for long stretches each time. Kissinger, out of his 3 volumes of memoirs, 3,500 pages of memoirs, presidents don't write 3,500 pages or anywhere close to that. He deals with the taping system in just a few paragraphs. And what he says about the tapes is, he says they're not a fair source of evidence for historians. He says, how can the tapes possibly be a fair source for scholars when one person knows the tapes exist, Nixon, and almost nobody else did? He sort of suggests that Nixon was choreographing conversations, and you know, how can that be a fair? People have to understand them. Well, I mean, of course they're interesting for historians. I mean, yes, tapes are flawed, and we can get into that later. But of course that's not correct. I mean, tapes are fascinating. This is the best source of evidence we have. You take a presidency that, by design, was one of the most secretive in U.S. history, is now becoming one of the most studied and documented. I mean, complete irony, because in part because of the tapes and the great documentary record that's been left. And so Kissinger says, that's what I remember him saying. So I was surprised during our meeting that he was showing such interest in the tapes. And I remember the first clip that I played, I forget which conversation it was, but what I said to him as a lead-in, just like I'll do a lead-in to let you know what you're going to hear in a minute, I said to Dr. Kissinger, we now know, because we've learned now, that he had his own recording system. It wasn't like Nixon's. There were a lot of tapes. What Kissinger had, they're called the Kissinger telcons. He had some secretaries listen in on some phone calls. They would make kind of a rough summary. Sometimes they could get pretty close to a transcript. Some of the ones were really good. But he didn't keep the tapes like Nixon. I'm not aware of any Kissinger tapes or anything like that. But I said to Dr. Kissinger during the meeting, but many times the president had you come into the Oval Office, he would say, you pick up that phone over there, call Soviet Ambassador Anatoly Dobrynin, and you tell him whatever it was of the day, threat, good news, you know, whatever it was. I said, when that happened, that means Nixon has a copy of that tape and you don't, which means I have a copy and you don't. So the first clip I played was a conversation between Kissinger and Dobrynin, and the content's lost to me now. They were talking about some really in-the-weeds conversation about Soviet-launched ballistic missiles, which I didn't think was particularly interesting. And so after the best 20 seconds or so, I was planning to move him on to the next one, and he waved me off, and he said he wanted to hear the whole thing. And that was the first moment, despite how he treated me in the meeting. Understandably so, he doesn't know who I am, no reason to trust me. That was the first moment when I thought maybe the meeting was going well from his perspective, because Kissinger hasn't shied away from this image of a ladies' man during the early 70s. I mean, pictured with lots of actresses he dated, and half of his staff were also very young and attractive when I was visiting him, including the one person in the room taking notes for him. It was when I started to play the first tape and he waved me off and wanted to hear it, that she closed the little steno pad, it was a little small one, closed it and put it down on the table. And I thought, maybe this is going okay. Played all the tapes that I had, went more than an hour beyond the meeting time that we had, and he cleaned me out. I had nothing more to offer him. And when we got to the very end of the meeting, despite what he had written and said about the tapes over the years, what he said to me was, I deeply respect the work that you do. See, when people look at my tapes, listen to them or read the books, it really doesn't matter to me whether you come away and you like Nixon more or you like him less. That's not what the purpose of this is. The purpose is making them available as a tool to the public and researchers. I mean, yeah, I have my own conclusions. You can read them in some of my other books, but the Nixon tapes work is designed to get the material out there in the hands of people. And I think that's the part that he liked. And the other thing he said to me, which was funny, was, now what can I do for you? And I thought, well, you know, what do you ask, you know, from Henry Kissinger, you know? Could you pay off my student loans? Could you help me finish my dissertation and get a job? But what I said was, one day I'll write a book about the Nixon tapes. Would you be willing to write an introduction for the book? And knowing that he hasn't really generally done that before. So asking him for something a little different. And he paused and he said, yes, I'll write a brief introduction. And then he immediately hedged it and said, of 3 to 4 pages. So already, you know, didn't want to get himself on the hook too much there. But when you look at the book, you'll see there is no introduction from Henry Kissinger. And the reason goes back to my philosophy. You know, I didn't want the books or the work broader than the books, because there's a lot more on the website than there are between two covers of a book. You can only make a book so big. I just didn't want the book to be officially endorsed, either by the Nixon side or by the critics. This was supposed to be, you know, straight down the middle, and you know, that's what it was meant to be always. So maybe I'll have another chance to do that, but not in these books. And on the way out, we got that photo. So I think we've covered most of this. The other point that I'll make, the effective PRIMPA. There's a lot of acronyms in the National Archives world. The Presidential Recordings and Materials Preservation Act was a law that, so Nixon resigned. We heard during the introduction, he departed the White House August 9th, 1974. There were plans for Nixon to build a presidential library out in California. There wouldn't have been much we could have done if he wanted to dump the tapes in the Pacific at that point. The law was different then. The tapes were, of all presidents, had been considered personal property for the most part. This was different because the tapes were evidence being used, in some cases, a growing number of court cases and litigation. We needed to preserve them. And Congress, after the pardon by President Ford, a month later, after Nixon left the White House, effectively seized the records and then passed this law signed by President Ford in December of 1974, which effectively made the records government property. And the interesting thing about this law was I've talked to a couple of archivists who work in the early 70s on the early prototype of the Nixon Library and the early tapes work. And in the law, I'm paraphrasing, what it basically says is when you get around to the archives, and you get around to processing these materials and releasing them, the American people deserve to know the truth about Watergate and abuse of the government power. And then you're prioritizing what is to be released to the public, you should put that material out first. And the effect of that law has been so damaging to Nixon, because that's what we've learned for about 20 years, was all that stuff had to come out all at one time in an intense batch, not in its context as it would come out for most presidencies. And so this has been one of the greatest challenges of working on the tapes, is I've done a lot of talks about the Nixon tapes, school groups and big groups and every other kind of group, and people come up to me all the time and say, what about that conversation where Nixon says this, 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 and this? I don't know what they're talking about. Or I had an early advisor in graduate school who said, you know, oh, I bet you hear this swear word all the time on the tapes. No, he says a lot of kind of four-letter words, but to be honest, LBJ is a lot better at swearing and a lot more colorful at it. I mean, LBJ talks more like someone who kind of truly never left the ranch. You know, Nixon is kind of East Coast kind of law firm four-letter, you know, word swearing. And the challenge of a lot of this tapes work is that people already know what they want to know about Nixon and are very resistant to being open-minded. And when 5% of the tapes, 5 to 7% of the tapes, has shaped basically 100% of what we know about Nixon, the other 95% don't really matter to most people. And that's what I'm working on. So that's my goal. And so along the way, Kissinger was the first meeting, but after that, there have been many others. And here's just a sampling of them over the years. Again, Kissinger was 86 when I met him. Most of these guys, because they all are guys for the most part, were crossing 70 years of age, 75, 80. They're just starting to slow down. They don't want to admit it, but they're just starting to slow down. They're thinking of legacy. They're writing memoirs. They're writing books. They're reflecting. And to do that, if you're Donald Rumsfeld writing your memoirs, or George Shultz is still working on his, or Vice President Cheney's written a number of books recently, the last Nixon brother, Ed Nixon, Nixon's main speechwriter, Ray Price, who wrote all of Nixon's major speeches, both inaugurals, all the State of the Unions, his resignation speech, collaborated on two or three of Nixon's post-presidency books. If you're going to write about the Nixon period and your time in it, you have to deal with the tapes. Because if you say, I met with the president on this day, and the tapes prove you wrong, you know, you can imagine what the media is going to do. Or some, you know, like George H.W. Bush, he cared most about what did Nixon say about me after I left the room. And there's a little criticism, but it's not as bad as he thought it was. And so the whole debunking of myths of the tape is a huge part of this work. And they all want to know, you know, what's on it. Because memories change in 40 years. I've been lucky through this work to, you know, the Nixon White House, it's a Nixon-Ford combined event. The Nixon-Ford White House, as far as I know, is the only White House is, to have an annual reunion each year. You can imagine how much fun that would be to attend. And since about 2010 or so, I've been the only academic allowed to attend those events. And they're fascinating. You hear a lot of things. Most of the time, I'm dying to ask a couple good questions. Politics is the last thing they want to talk about. They already live that. They want to talk about their grandkids and gardening and fishing and hunting and all kinds of stories like that. But for all of them to write about this, and many of them have had trouble writing about it. George Shultz wrote this huge memoir about his time as Secretary of State during the Reagan years, has never really written about the Nixon period. It's too hard for a lot of them. Rumsfeld was very careful in his. So they're all, the tapes present problems for all of them in many ways. So I won't say anything more about that, but this has been one of these unexpected things about this work, is it's sort of the excitement but the danger of working on recent history. People are still alive. Be careful. So to give you a couple of examples, President Nixon was very close to House Minority Leader Gerald Ford, the Republican leader in the House of Representatives, and counted on Ford. This is a picture from photo from 73. Counted on Ford really for kind of outreach, liaison roles in the House, kind of to get the mood of the Congress, and especially the Republican leaders and the committee chairman when a controversial issue was coming up, kind of to take the temperature at any given moment of Congress. So I have a couple of brief samples for you. Each one's about 2 minutes or less, and so I'll give you a brief sentence or two about each one. And we tested these out earlier, and they sounded pretty good. Sample one, October 18th, 1972, Nixon, newly elected majority leader in the House, Tip O'Neill, and Gerald Ford. And they're getting ready to talk about, again, people seem to think that the tapes are all about foul language and anti-Semitism, and they have this reputation. Most of them are just the business of government on most days. And so here you'll have, this is the business of government. The House is getting ready to adjourn, and it's customary for the House leaders, that's what we have there, except for the Speaker, to ask the president, do you have any more communications for the House before we adjourn for the year? Nixon says, no, but when you adjourn today, why don't you come over for a cup of coffee? So just kind of fun to hear the voices. So I'll play this one now. It'll run about a minute and a half, 2 minutes.
O'Neill, sir. You are.
Hello?
Mr. President.
Yes, Tip, how are you?
Fine, how are you?
Fine.
Well, Jerry is here with me, and we are calling on the annual report that we are the committee appointed to inform the Senate and to inform the President that Congress is ready to adjourn. Have you any further communications to make to the Congress?
No, I have no further communications except to wish you all the very best in the recess period. And also, I was going to suggest if you it would fit into your schedule, I'm expecting a call from the Senate at 3:30. That perhaps you might, if you had time, you could come down and have a cup of coffee about 4 o'clock down here, if that would meet with your schedules.
Well, if it meets with my schedule, I'll be delighted. I'll have you talk to Jerry.
Well, Mr. President, if we're through, and I hope we are through by that time, I'd love to do it. And
what I will do is to have Bill call you, your offices, as soon as we find out what the Senate is up to, you know, whether they'll be ready. And would the two of you inform the Speaker and ask him if he could come too? Obviously, we'd want him there too. But we would we'd like to talk a little before you go out for, shall we call it a vacation? Let's hope.
Not for the next 3 weeks.
Yeah, right.
Mr. President.
That's right.
Well, you're very nice to invite us down, and I think we'll get through here,
sure.
Yep, don't you?
I do. Right. Well, anyway, if it's later than 4, it could be 5, 6, any time. So I'll be here anyway.
Be delighted, Mr. President.
Yeah, good to talk to you, and we'll look forward to seeing you later this afternoon.
All thanks right. very much.
Bye.
Of course, these are far more typical of most of the Nixon conversations. Of course, the joke about vacation was what? They were all getting ready to campaign for the next 3 weeks. House, Senate, and of course, the President. And they mentioned reference to Bill Timmons, who was in the Ford and Nixon and Ford White House, did congressional affairs and liaison work. He was always the one Nixon talked to kind of know what the schedule was that day in Congress. And then here's one more, a short one we'll do, about the first 2 minutes of this one. The very different conversation. Nixon is now kind of getting in the thicket of the Watergate investigation. John Dean will be called to testify before the Irvin Committee, and as well as lots of other witnesses have not yet. And I think President Ford is giving Nixon a little advice about kind of how to get through it the coming days, coming weeks. And in particular, there's the first talk in the House of an article of impeachment. It's not yet introduced, but it's the first kind of discussion about possibly going to committee. And Ford is giving a little bit of advice on how to get through this.
Hello. Congressman Ford, sir.
Hi, hello, President.
Hi, Jerry. I had, Al had to go up to West Point, so I'm just checking on your friend McCloskey.
Well, I had about a 15-minute talk with him on the floor of the House.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, we disagree on most things. I have a good rapport with him. He is not going to urge that action. He is going to give, as I diagnosed his comments to me, a sort of academic discussion. He is not going to urge the direct action. He is not going to urge the action that would result in a resolution with it being referred to a committee. And after this somewhat lengthy discussion with him, I talked to Les and to one or two others, and it's our general opinion just to ignore it.
I agree.
And I talked to Louis Wyman, who, you know, is a charger.
Yeah.
And Louis was with me on this other matter a couple of years ago. And
Yeah, I know.
And I said, Louis, now, follow this line. And he said, well, I'm going to be here, and if he starts to get off the track, I'm going to challenge him. I said, well, just don't give him a forum and don't give him an opportunity to get a story. I think we can keep him under control.
Well, whatever it is, it's just another one of those stories, and it'll work out.
Well, Pete,
I appreciate your taking it. He's not a vicious fellow.
No, and he just goes off in these clouds. And if we ignore him, I think it'll be minimal. If we challenge him, it'll get blown way out of proportion.
That's right. Big constitutional debate.
Right.
Well, as a matter of fact, we got work to do for the country. I just had a... And by golly, Jerry, we're going to do it. And we're not going to let this Watergate stuff distract us.
I couldn't agree with you more in your comments at the breakup of the meeting. Very apropos. And I think we're on the track here of just the right approach.
It goes on a little bit more from there, but that's the essence of it. A couple of things. The idea that Watergate's just a distraction, you know, they can ignore. Yeah, hindsight, I guess, is everything. But you can see what it's like to listen to these tapes. At the beginning of that, when there was a mention of Al Haig, the chief of staff. So, I mean, the people talking to each other know what they're talking about. They're all friendly with each other. So it's just the challenge of getting through this. So we'll go on from there and kind of just wrap it up here in conclusion. And these actually are the good quality ones. You know, the telephone ones are among the best quality. The larger the room, the larger the chance for interference and noise and tick-tocking of clocks and people talking over each other. So the telephone ones tend to be the best. But in conclusion here, I think just a few points. I think Nixon's legacy is obviously complicated, to say the least. You know, as a nation, we love to rank former presidents. CNN and C-SPAN comes out with these rankings, and I don't know how much attention we should pay to them, but we have above average and we have below average, we have the best, we have the worst. And, you know, Nixon has consistently been at the bottom, if you're looking for him. And some presidents, generally speaking, kind of go up in popularity over time. I think those who lived through that time period, certainly with Nixon, those who lived through Vietnam, lived through Watergate, have a different perspective than the 18-year-olds in my classroom, who have had how many gates on the end of scandals and don't know what Watergate was, don't know what a draft was. They're going to have a very different view than those who lived through the time period. And it was Bill Clinton's eulogy at Nixon's funeral in 1994, where he called, in his view, to remember Nixon for everything, you know, not just Watergate, not just the bad. Little did he know in 94 that he's probably hoping someone says something similar about him one day as well. So a true act of bipartisanship, I think. And often people ask me, you know, even without Watergate, you know, if we could somehow pretend it didn't exist, where would the Nixon presidency rank? Well, I mean, what if? You know, you don't know. But it still would be anybody who sat in that seat during those years, it would have been a difficult presidency. The war going on, I mean, 4 more years of the war, Cambodia. I think in some ways Nixon's greatest fault is he just doesn't appear likable, you know, many times. Other presidents, Bill Clinton and others, were much better at kind of making personal connections. The difficulty for Nixon is you hear the true Nixon more on the tapes, but those were never public. So he never had a chance for people to really get to know him in some ways. The view of future generations, when I started this work 10 years ago, this is back of the envelope informally, I would say, 9 out of 10 questions I got were about Watergate and abuse of government power, about the tapes. Today, I would say half or a little less than half are. Now there's much more about China, much more about the Russians or other aspects, domestic policy. You know, to this day, there's still not a single good book about Nixon domestic policy, EPA and Amtrak, Wilderness Act, Endangered Species Act. I remember going to the LBJ Library in Austin early in my research, and in the gift store, they used to sell this T-shirt. And on the back, it had a list of all of LBJ's great society and domestic policy achievements. Now, I don't know if anybody can match that list other than FDR, but Nixon could come reasonably close with a list of domestic achievements. And no one's really ever written about this aspect of his presidency. So there's a lot of work. You know, despite what I've done and what's been done on other subjects, you know, we still have a long ways to go. 700 hours of tapes still to be released. More than Kennedy and Johnson recorded in their entirety. Still have not been released 40 years later. So all that we know about Nixon, we still have a lot more to learn. So with that, thank you. I'd be happy to take your questions and continue the conversation.
I'm curious what your reaction is to Max Frankel's characterization of you as a masochist in the New York Times book review, but I don't want to waste my question on that. I loved your quote in the introduction of the first book. The fact that everything he said was being saved appealed to his narcissistic sense of grandeur. And keying off of that, you mentioned Schlesinger's book, The Imperial Presidency, and said about that a little bit. Do you think that Nixon's view of the imperial presidency and himself convinced him that he would win any legal battle in regard to the tapes and therefore contributed to his downfall?
Well, there's a lot there to work with in terms of the question. I guess, first of all, I guess I am a masochist if Max Frankel says it. You know, he's sort of one of these remaining kind of deans of that era of prominent journalists who still is very active in writing for national audiences now for almost 50 years. And just in case you're curious, this was a CBS Sunday morning. I was been on, you know, all this attention I never expected. And this was not Frankel, but Marvin Kalb, another cohort of Frankel and Carl Bernstein and Doug at the premiere. But to get to your question, it's complicated. I think the book, The Imperial Presidency, was published in 1973. But it had been building for, you could argue, the whole Cold War, the idea. I mean, in some ways, based on what I hear on the tapes, presidents had a history of sort of abusing the FBI and the CIA. Going back as far as you can go back, you know, Nixon's problem, I think, that was unique, truly unique, to his view of the imperial presidency. You know, it's like he said to, if the president does it, it's not wrong. Nixon's problem was, I think, if he had simply abused those agencies, illegal wiretaps and things like that, the way that other presidents had, I think he would have done okay. Nixon's unique problem was the creation of the White House plumbers. Not using those agencies the way that others had, but internalizing the capability within the White House, reporting to you, to do break-ins and wiretaps and things of that sort. Nixon would have to take the fall for that when they're caught, and that's what happened. So the idea had been building for a long time, but I do think that Nixon had this certain idea, not that the president, I don't know if it was above the law, but the president had rights that maybe the rest of us didn't have. And it's one of the greatest questions. I think, to get answer your last part, Nixon wasn't convinced of that, because if he would have been, then he would have gone to the Senate, gone to trial. Obviously, he had some doubts. Whether it would have been the trial in the Senate and or a later criminal or civil trial, probably would have gone on after that, I think it still remains one of the greatest misjustices. You know, I would have liked to have known what happened with that. So we'll never know. So I don't know what Nixon was convinced of. He was getting a lot of conflicting evidence, advice in those final weeks of the presidency. I think he probably said it best to David Frost, that when the president does it, it's not illegal.
Thank you.
I guess I came hoping for some scoops about the Nixon presidency. You probably spent more time with the tapes than any of the other authors who've worked on them. Could you tell us two or three things that you learned of some historical significance about Nixon and his operations that we wouldn't know from the other books?
Sure. There are a few things that come to mind. One is that when Nixon came to the White House, he was very critical of Johnson for, in his view, micromanaging the war. And the tapes show to me that Nixon micromanaged the war to a degree that even Johnson didn't. In some of the phone calls that are in the first of the yellow-covered book of the Nixon tapes, you see some of the conversations between Nixon and chairman of the JCS, Moore, with the defense secretary, Mel Laird, and with others. I mean, Nixon's calling out demands for specific sorties and payloads and targets. He's getting way, you know, into the weeds that I would think a president probably wouldn't want to get into. So I think Nixon micromanaged the war in some ways more than Johnson did. The other thing about the war that struck me was in 1971, I mean, we look back now, 18-year-olds, you know, the Nixon administration to them is just as ancient as the American Civil War. It happened so long ago, and nobody knows anything about it. To 18-year-olds, they don't even know about 9/11 anymore. I mean, maybe unless they had a very early memory growing up in New York or Washington, I suppose. But in 1971, you know, they study, well, Nixon won in one of the greatest landslides in 72 against Senator McGovern. In 71, it didn't look very good for Nixon. His polls were down. It didn't look like he was going to win at all, let alone in a landslide. And there were two conversations I can think of where Nixon and Kissinger are discussing the Vietnam War, when Nixon suggests resigning or not running for re-election. And that was new to me. At first I thought, oh, that can't be serious. You know, it sounds like sort of political talk that you hear today in an election year. But you think about it, and not in 2016 terms, but think about it in 1971 terms. That's exactly what Johnson did in 68. Went on TV on March 31st and said, I will not, you know, stand for re-election. If I'm nominated, I won't take the nomination. And so I think that was a real idea. And Nixon says, Vietnam has already destroyed one presidency. I won't let it destroy two. I'd rather resign. And so the trauma that he went through in 70, 71, he was, not very confident about his policies. Until he got that breakthrough with China in July of 71, the announcement that he would go to China, until the Soviets started talking to him, nobody wanted to talk to him. The Chinese weren't talking to him. The Soviets weren't talking to him. The North Vietnamese weren't talking to him. I mean, all of his major initiatives were stalled just a year before they all happened in 72. So I was just surprised by, it makes you feel that no matter what your politics are, just how impossible that job is, it's impossible, the kind of conflicts you have to deal with. So, and the third thing I'll say, we're not going on too long, I want to get to the next question, was how Nixon didn't use the tapes or media the way he should. This is somebody who grew up in the media age, who gave the Checkers speech in 52 to stand the ticket with Eisenhower, who used media very effectively. The silent majority speech in November of 69, the sort of the original, not Donald Trump's silent majority, I mean the silent majority. And yet there were moments that I hear on the tapes that he failed to capitalize on that. Maybe not shrewd enough. I mean, he would meet with POW wives. I mean, he's very warm and nice. And you think, this never got out. It never helped to improve the image. Nixon commiserated often about the Kennedys and Camelot and the press. And why can't I have that kind of image? The reason is because of Richard Nixon. He wasn't John F. Kennedy. And he didn't take advantage of opportunities that he could have taken advantage of on the tapes. There's some very warm moments in the tapes that I think would change your mind about, you know, who Nixon was. Very different Nixons, depending on which hour of tape you listen to, whether he's shrewd or whether he's warm. Very different, like a prism, you know, many have said. Yep.
As we all know, the healthcare debate is still very prominent in the national dialogue. I was just wondering, how much content does there seem to be about the president's relationship with Edgar Kaiser and the talk about the HMO legislation at that time and those sorts of things?
It's a good question. There is some about Kaiser on the tapes, not as much. Domestic policy in general is harder than foreign policy on the tapes because Nixon considered himself to be a foreign policy expert. This was not something he had to widely delegate to staff. This was his policy. And foreign policy is much easier to do on the tapes because it's really a story with a beginning, a middle, and an end. I mean, Kissinger's coming in today at 8 a.m. and telling you what's new. He'll come back in 2 hours. He'll be in there in the afternoon, then in the evening before the day's over. I mean, you hear the policy and it's all stages of progression. Domestic policy is harder because Nixon is involved, but he's involved less and in different ways. It's not these constant updates and evolution of the policy. You know, he might have John Ehrlichman come in at the beginning of the week and say, we're meeting with the domestic council today, and we're talking about this, or the urban affairs council, or the doctors are here today, the science advisory council's here. And then you kind of, as a listener, like, what happened? You know, and then maybe 3 weeks later, well, we talked about this. It's not a consistent story the way it is with foreign policy. Because, of course, one of the great flaws about the tapes, this is only Nixon's perspective. And it's only in certain locations where taping existed. And he didn't tape everywhere. LBJ taped on Air Force One. Nixon didn't. Nixon didn't tape in San Clemente, California. He didn't tape, as far as we know. He didn't tape in Florida when he was down in Key Biscayne. So you have the additional problem of the tapes in that way. So you get domestic policy, but it would not be kind of two fat books, you know, like these books were, Foreign Policy and Watergate. It'd be a smaller volume, I think still worth doing, whether I do it or somebody else does it. But it's just not going to have the excitement and intensity that foreign policy does. So it's there. But it's there much more sporadically, and it's hard. It's sort of like putting a puzzle together, but you don't have all the pieces, in a way.
So you've mentioned that in today's, that 18-year-olds and the younger generation live in a vastly different political climate, where we have many scandals every few months. So keeping that into consideration, how do you think the younger generation will impact Nixon's legacy, and how do you think we will set a precedent for a potential future Watergate?
Good questions. I'm waiting to find out. until another scandal is at the point where a president resigns, Nixon's still going to be the only president who resigned. It's not going to change. So there's a certain intensity, about Watergate that's not going to go away until it's replaced in our memory by something as acute or as severe as Watergate. But the sample that I have, teaching U.S. history for about 10 years, is the students that I know that are 18 and 20 years old, they haven't lived at a time when really the budget's been balanced, when there's been a normal budget process in Washington, it's been constant gridlock and everything else. And I remember during the 2004 election, it seems like so long ago now, and I remember the media constantly at a certain point in that race, Bush versus Kerry, when the media were saying, we are probably more divided now than ever before. And how many times have you heard this? And the 18-year-olds who have been learning about history for all of 2 weeks could say, weren't we more divided during the Civil War? Or during civil rights? There's a few times I can think of where I think we were more divided than 2004, which who remembers that, 2004? So I think we're always so focused on now that we never have this time for reflection. And I hope the younger generation has more time for reflection. But generally, they want to know, they read the textbooks in their survey courses, and they want to know, what else? The questions that I get are, what else? This has been studied for so long. You've shown there's the other 95% of the tapes, and they want to know about Watergate, but they want to know about other things too. So I'm not trying to diminish Watergate, just present it in its context. It's 5% of the tapes. It's an awfully important 5%, but it's still 5% of the tapes.
You made reference to Stanley Cutler as having written a number of books about the tapes. Well, Cutler, who I believe now is deceased, actually both he and I are from the University of Wisconsin, and hence my curiosity. Is your appraisal of Nixon similar to that of Stan Cutler's?
And my connection to him is he and I are both from Bowling Green State University. We both got our undergraduates there before he went on to Madison. But he was someone I knew before he died. Generally speaking, his view of Nixon was far more critical because he was focused primarily on Watergate and abuse of government power. There's no way you can study the Watergate tapes in abuse of government power and come away being an admirer of Richard Nixon. It's just not possible, no matter how much of a hardened partisan you are. So that was his work, his book, Abuse of Power, The New Nixon Tapes, his book, Wars of Watergate. Those books are 25 years old, and I still use them in my classes. There's been nothing better since, and there needs to be. It's been a long time. A lot more records have been released since then. A lot more tapes have been released since then. But he focused intensely on about 200 hours of tapes. That was no one had ever done that before. 200 hours of tapes, one person. The National Archives, when it started processing these tapes, estimated 100 or more hours of staff time for every hour of tape to listen, to transcribe, to process. So transcribing had to go out the window at that point. It wasn't possible. So for someone to tackle 2,000 hours was monumental when he did it. It's still monumental. No one surpassed it today on the subject of Watergate. I've done non-Watergate subjects for the most part. So because of that, I think he's more critical, because his parameters are focused on material that's critical.
Thank you. Are the 3,000 hours or 3,451 hours digitized at this point?
I can only speak for the number that are already released, publicly released. I don't have access to tapes that are not released, and approximately 3,000 are released now. Since 2007, the National Archives has tended to release them to the public in the available technology of the day. And for a while that was cassette, then for a while it was CD, and then now when they're released, they go right to a website as MP3 files. So since 2007, they put them directly on a website. Before then, they were, if you wanted to go to make a copy of the tapes, you had to listen to cassettes and bring blank cassettes with you. Where do you buy blank cassettes nowadays? eBay, I guess, is the answer. So the reason they're digitized is because I digitized them. I spent about 5 years and digitized them, and they're on the website, nixontapes.org. So they all are digitized now.
So there were three articles of impeachment, and the one that gets put under the rug is the Blue Plains sewage treatment plant, where Nixon refused to spend the money, which probably exceeded presidential power. And that might have been the most important thing that was there. Is there any discussions in the tape of how he was going to get around that in impeachment?
I have to admit, I've never looked specifically for that. So there could be, but I'm not aware of anything. Sometimes people say, have you really listened to all the tapes? Well, I mean, you don't sit down and listen straight through. You listen to Vietnam and China, and you go thematically, not chronologically all the way through. So I've never looked for that. And even now, when I re-listen to things I've heard before, I understand them differently. There are things I pick up on that I didn't understand before. I mean, look at the second example I played here. When they're talking about the procedure, the motion, the word impeachment was never used. So this is what I mean. You listen to things, you have to, so that in some cases, it's hiding in plain sight when they're discussing some things. And it takes a, I could hear that same, when you transcribe something, transcription is far more a work of art than a work of science. You could listen to something 100 times and be sure you've got it. Every utterance, every false start, every pause, however you note these things on your transcript, and you put it the transcript down, you work on something else. You go play with your kid or you do something, you clear your short-term memory because you force yourself to do something very different. You come back to it, and the 101st time, you hear something different. Nothing changed. I mean, just it's the human mind. And this, I think, has a lot to do with why the National Archives made the right decision and didn't transcribe these things. Because I know back in 1980, they tried to do that, and researchers came in. I hear something a little different. This, I'm not sure about this word. That's how it is. It's a work of art. It's not science. You can't get it 100% right. You're always going to have unclear things where reasonable people are going to disagree on what you hear. And so I try to make sure I get at least the substance right. That if I'm going to make mistakes, I try not to take guesses over things that change the meaning of conversations. So the short answer, or the long answer, is it could be there, but I'm not aware. Thank you.
Read John Dean's book, The Nixon Defense. In the introduction, he claims to be the only person who ever listened to all the tape and compared it to the transcript, which struck me as bizarre. I mean, here's this great treasure trove of history, and the only guy to look at it is the guy who was an actor in the story. Do you think that's true? And if it is true, what are all our PhD students doing? I mean, why would you go to medieval Italy for some archive when this great story of American history is right?
Well, I told you what I was doing. I don't know what the rest of them are doing. I was down in the salt mine. He and I have had an up and down relationship over the years. That book, I would characterize that book as being probably the most thorough book about Watergate conversations to date, based on all the newly released tapes, except they don't include John Dean. That's a fact. And he says that right in the preface of the book. He says, I've written about my role in Watergate before. I'm not going to write about it again. And I think to critics, the problem with that is 40 years have elapsed since he published Blind Ambition in the mid-1970s, his memoir about his role in Watergate. And he's written some other things too, but that was his primary story during Watergate. And that he hasn't gone back and talked about all the newly released these tapes. So that book is full of transcripts, but it leaves him out of them. And he was the president's counsel on Watergate. So the way I'd like to answer your question is to say, who are the main authorities today on Watergate? Don't they all have a tie to the subject? And that's when I say it'll take a change occurs in generations. And I think it won't be until we get to a generation a little more with a little more professional distance from the time period when we'll get a better history of that time period.
I'd like your opinion on what did you feel about Ford allowing the president to resign?
I don't know if he had much of a say in the resignation.
To allow him to resign from when he was, rather than being charged for what took place. Ford said you'll retire.
Well, I think some of his aides told him to stick with it. His daughter Julie famously wrote a note on her pillow that said, I'm paraphrasing, Daddy, fight it out, you'll win, I'll always love you, I'll always be proud of you. There are some people who said you should have fought it out, that if you believed you were innocent, you should have done it the way you or I would if we were accused of something. I think in the end, I think President Ford and others didn't have a say. It was really the Republicans in the Senate who came to Nixon and said, you don't have the votes. And I think at that point, Nixon said he really had foreclosed on all of his options at that point.
Do presidents still tape?
Well, as a historian, I wish they all taped. Even if we have to close them for 50 or 75 years, you know, the idea that we could one day know everything is a fascinating idea. My hunch is they've learned from Nixon, and that no one tapes. The official government answer is there has been limited taping. Reagan, I think, even maybe Ford a little bit. Clinton, I saw some records at the Clinton Library in the Oval Office. And you know, when you work with transcripts, you recognize transcripts. You think there must have been a recording at one point. And some of them, they said, oh, they're not transcripts. And I looked at them, and the top of the document says side A and side B. Well, I grew up in a generation where I know what side A and side B are. But the official Clinton, and I got Judy Woodruff involved in this, and she got an answer from the Clinton Library, and their official answer was, there was limited taping in the Clinton Oval Office. It was only with speechwriters who were there to fact check and to capture certain phrases they wanted to make sure were included verbatim in certain speeches, and that it was nothing more than that. So I think in the same way that Nixon surprised us and other presidents surprised us they taped, there are bound to be surprises that pop up. But as far as we know, no one taped comprehensively like Nixon.
Luke, that was a very fascinating look into the tapes from the Nixon administration. As a token of our appreciation, we have a special gift, a pen set with Gerald Ford's signature on it.
Thank you.
So thank you again. Thank you to the audience for the wonderful questions, as always. Two quick program announcements before we adjourn. On Thursday, May 5th, author Joel Goldstein will discuss his new book, The White House Vice Presidency, The Path to Significance. And on Tuesday, March 10th, the Ford Library is hosting a Red Cross blood drive from 12 to 6 p.m. So we encourage any... May. I'm sorry, May 10th. Thank you. Thank you for keeping me grounded. I'm having a long day. On Tuesday, May 10th, the Ford Library is hosting a Red Cross blood drive from 12 to 6 p.m., so we encourage any blood donors or prospective blood donors to join us for that special event or simply help us spread the word. We appreciate that, too. And finally, program flyers are available outside the auditorium, as are forms for joining Friends of Ford and our email announcements list. So thank you for your patience with that. And now we invite you to our reception where you can meet our speaker and enjoy a cookie or two, which I hear are pretty good. So thank you again for coming.
Thanks.